Fine. So last class we talked about the introduction of vectors, which was primarily revolving around the type of vectors, addition of vectors, and I also talked about resolving vectors into components, right? Which also included the concept of direction cosines when we talked about resolution of vectors in 3D space. Okay. So today I'm going to begin with the scalar multiplication. The scalar multiplication in vectors. As the word itself says, you are multiplying a scalar and a vector over here. So let's say lambda is a scalar quantity and A is a vector. So if you're multiplying it, what are you doing to the vector? You are either scaling the vector up or scaling the vector down, or you are reversing the direction and or you are reversing the direction of the vector. So if lambda is negative, okay, you are reversing the direction of the vector. Okay. So if lambda is positive, there is no change in the direction. No change in the direction. Okay. If mod lambda is greater than 1, basically you are scaling up the vector. That means you are elongating it, okay? And if modulus of this is less than 1, of course has to be greater than 0. That means you are scaling down the magnitude of the vector. In short, what I want you to know is, when you multiply a vector by a scalar quantity, you end up getting a vector parallel to itself, okay? In words of vectors, we call A and lambda A to be collinear to each other. That's why in many problem solving, if somebody says, write a vector in the direction of a particular vector, we normally choose that vector as lambda times that vector in direction of whose we want a vector. Okay. Now this reminds me, this concept is very simple to look at, but this reminds me of a very important concept, which I'm going to take up next. That concept is finding the vector along the bisectors of two given vectors. So finding a vector along the bisector of two given vectors. Okay. So let's say we have a vector A like this, and there's another vector B like this. Okay. Let us prove one important thing that is going to be used as a result also later on for us. If you're bisecting the angle between A and B, that means let's say this angle and this angle are same. Okay. You are bisecting the angle between A and B. Then this yellow vector, let me call it as C vector, can be represented as lambda times A by mod A plus B by mod B. Can we take up a minute or so to prove this? Because this result is an important result, and this will be used to solve a lot of questions later on when we are dealing with vector equations of lines, etc. Let me just check how many people have joined in. Megha has joined in, Nikita has joined in. Good afternoon. Nikita, your exams are over? DPS? Yes, good. And how about Aditya Arvind? Exams are over? Oh, they end on October 1st. Okay. Do you have any paper tomorrow? No, sir. Okay. So today is the last class before vacations. Let me remind you, 30th of September, you have an online test, JEE Main 10 to 1. Don't forget to take that test. Yes. Anyone, any success in this? A lot of information can be gathered from the result itself. This is nothing but A cap. This is nothing but A cap. This is nothing but B cap. If you're done, you can unmute yourself and explain me the result. Anyone? Okay, so let me try this out for you all. So if you take a unit vector along A, let's say I make a unit vector along A. So I'm making the same diagram now with a unit vector. So this is your A cap. Okay. You got it, Vidushi?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's take a unit vector along B cap. Unit vector means vector of length unity. So if I take a angle bisector of this, okay, can I say angle bisector would actually be a line connecting the co-initial points of A and B, let me call this point as O, to the midpoint of this extremities of A and B, isn't it? Do you all agree with me or not? Let's say I call this point as point P. Okay, do you realize that the angle bisector, right, would actually be a vector which will pass through P also. P is nothing but it's the midpoint of, let me call this as M and N. Okay, P is the midpoint of M and N. Do you agree with me or not? Of course, because I have made a isosceles triangle over here. In isosceles triangle, the bisector of the angle of the two equal sides will actually touch the opposite side at its midpoint. Right? Now, if I have to find out what is my position vector of P, what will you say? Very simple. Since OM is the vector which is actually signifying the position vector of point M, so we can say B cap is the position vector of M. Similarly, A cap would be the position vector of N. So P point will be A cap plus B cap by 2 according to the section formula. Okay, see, this is one of the good advantages of knowing position vectors. So OP vector would be a vector which is going to be, let me not write OP cap because it's not a unit vector. So OP vector will be nothing but A cap plus B cap by 2. Okay, now C vector is collinear to OP vector. That means this C vector will actually lie parallel to the OP vector, right? If it is flying parallel to the OP vector, I can write C as some alpha times this by 2, where alpha is some scalar quantity, If that is the case, I can write C as alpha by 2, A cap plus B cap. Alpha by 2, I can start calling as a different scalar quantity. Let me call it as lambda. So it will be lambda times A cap plus B cap. Okay, and A cap is nothing but A by mod A, B cap is nothing but B by mod B. Okay, and therefore any angle bisector vector could be represented as this. Okay, very important result. Please remember this as a very important concept, because there are problems which are directly asking you to find out the bisector of the angle of any two vectors. Of course, some information would be provided to you to get lambda and all. Okay. By the way, I have a small question for all of you. What if I asked you the external angle bisector vector for this? You understand the meaning of external angle bisector? So now let us say my A vector is like this. B vector is like this. Okay, and this is the angle, external angle. Okay, this is the external angle. So what is the external angle bisector vector for this?
So is it A minus B by 2?
So no. Yeah. What did you say, Vidushi?
A minus B by 2.
A minus B by, absolutely correct. So basically what is going to be changing here is that You're just trying to find out the internal angle bisector of A and minus B now. So all you need to do is your B will be replaced with minus B. So you can say external angle bisector is basically lambda times or any scalar times A by A modulus A minus B by modulus B. That exactly comes from A minus B, A cap minus B cap by 2 formula. Is that fine? So this result also is important. Keep this in mind. Any questions so far? Arya is there, Shaunak is there. Guys, please be on time, because normally when I start with a new concept and you have not joined in, you lose out on very important things. Okay. Arya, exam is over. Arya, Shaunak, are your exams over? Today only over, or it was over like... Okay, Shaunak, exam is over mid-October. Okay. Arya, exam got over today only? Last week, okay. Chalo, enjoy. So let's have a question on this. Let's take a question on this. Next up, vector questions. Okay, hope you can read this question. The question says, find a unit vector C if minus I plus J minus K bisects the angle between C and 3I plus 4J. Question is clear? So you have to find, you have been given the bisector actually. This is your bisector. This is your bisector of these two vectors, vector C and vector 3I plus 4J. You have to find the C vector in this case. You have to find this vector in this case. Either you can type the answer as a response on the chat box, or you can just speak out the answer. I'll give you 3 minutes to do this. Time starts now. Anyone? Any success? Hi, Gargi. Good afternoon. Okay, so let us assume that our C vector is xi plus yj plus zk. Okay, now it's known that C is a unit vector. That implies mod C should be equal to 1, which implies x square plus y square plus z square should be equal to 1. Correct? Now this given vector, that is minus I plus j minus k, should be lambda times A by A cap. In this case, A is your C, okay? And C by C cap is nothing but C itself, because C itself is a unit vector. So you don't have to divide by under root of x square plus y square plus z square, because that is already given to you as 1. It's a unit vector. Plus 3i plus 4j divided by 5. So essentially, what have I used? I've used the formula that the bisector of A and B, let's say this is the angle bisector. Okay, so C vector is given by, let me not call it C because C is already been used here, let me call it as P vector. P vector is A cap plus B cap times lambda. Okay, that's what I have used over here. Now we can compare the coefficients. Since I, J, K are on both the sides, we can compare the coefficients of these vectors. So minus 1 is equal to lambda x plus 3 by 5. Okay, that's one equation. Other equation will be 1 is equal to lambda y plus 4 by 5. And the third equation is minus 1 is equal to lambda z. Correct? Let us try to get x in terms of lambda. So from here, I got a response. That's absolutely correct. That's correct, Vidushi. That's correct. So Vidushi has already given the answer. Okay. So from here I can write sorry, this is also lambda. Yeah. So from here I can write lambda times 5x plus 3 is equal to minus 5, right? So lambda is, or x, you can say x is, let me make x the subject of the formula, x in terms of lambda. So lambda x is minus 1 minus 3 lambda by 5. That is minus 5 plus 3 lambda by 5 lambda is your x. Okay. Now let me find y in terms of lambda. So lambda y is equal to 1 minus 4 lambda by 5. That means y is equal to 5 minus 4 lambda by 5y. 5 lambda. Okay. And already z is equal to minus 1 by lambda. Now these values of x, y, and z, we can use it in the equation over here, which was x square plus y square plus z square equal to 1. So let's use this. Let me name it as 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay. So I'm using 1, 2, 3, 4 in 1. So using 2, 3, 4 in equation number 1, I would end up getting 5 plus 3 lambda by 5 lambda whole square. 5 minus 4 lambda by 5 lambda whole square, 1 by lambda square is equal to 1. Right? Let us multiply throughout with 25 lambda square. So 5 plus 3 lambda square plus 5 minus 4 lambda square plus 25 is equal to 25 lambda square. Okay? Now, I'm sure when you expand this, there will be a 25 lambda square, which will get cancelled with this. You will get, other than that, From here you will get 60 lambda, and from here you will get minus 40 lambda, and other than that you will end up getting 25 plus 25, which is 50, is equal to 0. Is that fine? Is there anything which I am missing out? Oh, sorry, 75 it will be, not 25, 75. 25, 25, 25 will be 75. Yeah. So here we get 10 lambda is 75, which means lambda is equal to 15 upon 2. Okay. Bus done. Our job is done. I just have to put this value of lambda and get my value of x, y, and z respectively. Correct. So if I use it in the second equation, lambda is 15 by 2, I'll get minus 5 plus 15 by 2 will be 45 by 2 divided by 5 into 15 by 2. Right? That will give me 1055 minus 55 by 75, which is nothing but minus 11 by 15. Okay, so x value is minus 11 by 15. Let's put in y also. So y will be, let me put in the original equation. I think this will be much easier to find. So y will be 1 minus 4 lambda by 2, that is 60 by 2 divided by 5 into 15 by 2. That's going to be 10 minus 50 by 75. That's 10 by 15. Let me check. 5 minus. Yeah. Minus 10 by 15. Hope I have not made any sign error. Just confirm. 1 plus 1 is equal to 15 by 2y plus 4 by 5 into 15 by 2. 15. Yeah, y is correct. Yeah. Next is z. Z would be minus 1 by lambda, which is minus 2 by 15. Correct. So having found out x, y, z, my c vector would be xi, which is minus 11 by 15i, minus 10 by 15, or you can say minus 2 by 3, j minus 2 by 15. Clear? Is that fine? Any doubt regarding this? Okay. Clear, everyone? Shaunak? Great. So as you can see, this concept proved very, very handy for solving this problem. Right? And it has very wide application. So if you start solving your previous year questions also, you realize that this concept has been widely asked at so many places. Okay. Now, next concept which I'm going to take up is very vital because it will be a founding concept for your understanding of collinearity and coplanarity of vectors and points. That is the concept of linear combination. Okay. Try to understand this linear combination term, because from it I'm going to talk about linear dependency and linear independency of vectors. Okay. This concept is missing from your NCERT syllabus. Okay. So first of all, let me make you understand what is the meaning of saying that a vector is a linear combination of, you know, a system of vectors. So we say that a vector R is a linear combination. This word is very important, because when I'm using this word, you should know what do I mean by using, you know, by the use of linear combination phrase. Okay. So this phrase is very important. So we say a vector R is a linear combination of, let's say, a system of vectors a1, a2, a3, etc. till an. If R could be expressed as scalar times these vectors, that means there exists scalars m1, m2, m3, etc. till mn. So let me write here where m1, m2, m3, etc. till mn are scalar quantities. Okay. If R could be expressed as scalar times a1 plus some other scalar times a2 plus some other scalar times a3 like this, we actually say R is a linear combination of this system of vectors. Okay. Now, some terms associated with it are linearly independent and linearly dependent. So let me first take up the concept of, when do we say a set of vectors or a system of vectors are linearly independent? Again, see, what I want you here to focus on is the terminology which I am going to use here. The terminology is going to be useful because when you read this in your textbooks or when somebody is explaining you a particular concept, probably he will make the use of these words like linear combination or linear independent. So even for problem solving, I'll make use of such words. Okay, there you should understand what do I imply by use of these words. So when I say a system of vectors a1, a2, a3, etc. till an are linearly independent. What do I mean by this? What I mean is, if you express a linear combination of these vectors, see, again, I'm using the word linear combination, so you should know what I'm talking about. So if you express a linear combination of these vectors as a null vector, okay, then all your scalar quantities involved over here must be zero. That is, all your m1, m2, etc. till mn must be zero. Then only we say these vectors are linearly independent of each other. Right? To give you an example, vector I, j, and k cap are actually linearly independent. They're actually linearly independent. Okay? Why? Because if you try to find out three scalar quantities m1, m2, m3, such that if you express this as a null vector, right, then it can only be possible if each of these components m1, m2, m3 are individually zero. Getting my point? This is another way of saying K cannot be produced by, K cannot be generated by some scalar times I plus some scalar times j, okay, where x and y here are scalar quantities.
Are linearly independent vectors always perpendicular?
No, not necessarily. Linearly independent means one vector cannot be expressed using the other two vectors. Let's see if I talk about linear independence of three vectors. Remember, linear independence can also be applied to two vectors. Okay. For example, I and j. Okay. I'm just giving an example of I and j because they're simple to connect to. I and j are linearly independent. That means no matter what you do, you can never produce I from some lambda times j vector. No lambda would exist like this. Lambda cannot exist here. There's no lambda. You can say this cannot happen for any lambda belonging to real number. Okay. In other words, if you find, if you try to do this operation, that means if you express the linear combination of I and j as null vector, you will only conclude that m1 and m2 can be zero. Right? That's why we normally try to express a vector in terms of I and j and k, because they are linearly independent. One doesn't share any component with the other. Right? The purpose of using I, j, k to express any vector or to resolve any vector was the basic principle that it is, they are linearly independent of each other. There is no component of a one vector in line of the other. That means there, there is no dependency of these vectors on one another. Getting the point? So in the previous example, you would have seen that when I compared the coefficient, let me go back to the previous page when I was solving the problem of angle bisector, right? So easily I compared my I with I, J with J, K with K, correct? Because I knew that if I bring everything one side, I will get something like something I, something J, something K, correct? And this is null vector, and I, J, K are linearly independent. So all these something must be individually zero. That actually led to these three equations that you have, you actually solved. Getting my point? This could only be possible. Here actually I did not tell you what was the reason behind, you know, comparing I with J. See, you cannot do that if your vectors were linearly dependent on each other. Are you getting my point? So let me take that concept first before I talk about anything else. What is the meaning of linearly dependent? By the way, all of you, please make a note of this. When I say a system of vectors are linearly independent, what do I actually mean by it? This is the mathematical definition, but in a plain and simple word, just try to understand that you cannot express any one of these vectors in terms of the other vector. That is the meaning of linearly independent of each other. Right? Hope you have noted this down. Okay. Let me now talk about vectors being linearly dependent. Again, a system of vectors a1, a2, etc., let's say till an, are said to be linearly dependent if a linear combination of these vectors, when expressed as a null vector, okay, implies all m1, m2, implies all m1, m2 till mn are not zero. All are not zero. Just like in the previous case, every scalar quantity m1, m2, etc. till mn was zero. In this case, at least few of them, right, should not be zero. For example, I plus J and J. These three vectors, I've just taken a simple example. Let me take a 2i and 3j also. Okay. These three vectors are linearly dependent. Okay. Because if you try to express a linear combination of these vectors as a null vector, you would realize that there will be some m1, m2 non-zero values also for which this is possible. Okay, let me show you how. In this case, m1i, m2 will be nothing but 2m2, 3m3j. Okay, This means M1 could be 0. But 2M2 plus 3M3 equal to 0 can lead to so many non-zero values of M2 and M3. For example, here M2 could be, let's say, 3. M3 could be minus 2. Okay. So as you can see, not all of them are 0. In other words, you could express one vector in terms of the other two. That is the meaning here when you say they are linearly dependent. For example, I plus j could be expressed as half of 2i and 1/3 of 3j. Getting my point? So here, these three vectors are linearly dependent on each other. Are you getting my point? Is the difference between linearly independent and linearly dependent clear in your mind? Mathematically speaking, I'm just going to state these two important characteristics. If a1, a2, a3 till an are linearly independent, they would satisfy this property. Okay. And if these vectors are linearly independent, then they would satisfy this property. Is that clear? Okay. What is important per se is the two theorems which are related to linear independence and linear dependence. The two theorems are, number one, a pair of collinear vectors. Collinear means what in your mind, when you read this word collinear, what should come in your mind? Parallel. Okay. A pair of collinear vectors are always linearly dependent. This is the one which is of use to us directly in problem solving. Okay. A pair of collinear vectors are always linearly dependent. And second theorem that we are required to know is that a triad of coplanar vectors. Guys, let me tell you, you'll get a direct question on coplanarity and collinearity in your school exams also. Okay. A triad of coplanar vectors are always linearly dependent. Okay. And the opposite is also true. That means, let's say I call it as 1A. So 1B means a pair of non-collinear vectors are always linearly independent. Okay. And similarly, 2B, a triad of non-coplanar vectors. You understand the meaning of triad, right? Three. A triad of non-coplanar vectors are always linearly independent. Okay. A triad of non-coplanar vectors are always linearly independent. Getting your point? The conclusion here from the second 2a and 2b is that, so from 2a and 2b you can say more than three vectors are always linearly dependent. Okay, because the fourth vector, right, would actually become dependent on some of the vectors, right? Okay, so we say, I don't know whether you have learned about cross product or not in school. So any vector in 3D space, okay, any vector in 3D space could actually be expressed as XA plus YB plus ZA cross B. Okay, so this vector becomes linearly dependent on these three vectors, right? But A, B and A cross B are linearly independent. Let me tell you, because they will never be coplanar, right? They are triads of vectors which are never be coplanar. I'm sure you would have learned cross product. This is always perpendicular to the plane containing A and B. How many of you have not done vectors in school at all? Are ye to physics ka concept hai. I think you should be knowing it, right? We all know that A cross B is perpendicular to the plane containing A and B. So A, B and A cross B forms a triad of linearly independent vector. So by using these triad, just like IJK, see IJK also follows the same nature, right? Let's say A is I cap, B is J cap, then A cross B has to be K cap. So kisi bhi vector ko you can actually express as a linear combination of IJK. That is what we call as resolving vectors, isn't it? So in the same way, I've just given you a broader, this is a broader understanding of your resolving of vectors. This is a broader interpretation of resolution of vectors. Okay. So resolution of vectors is nothing but it's a scope which comes under the concept of linear independence and linear dependence. Getting my point? This is slightly deep. It requires a bit of, you know, deeper understanding. It doesn't come very naturally. And that's why, since this concept is slightly challenging, it is missing from your NCERT and you know, CBSE curriculum. Okay. So these theorems, please keep them in mind. Okay, I'll repeat them once again. A pair of collinear vectors are always linearly. Good evening, Aniruddha. You joined too early. Class started at 4. So, yeah, a pair of collinear vectors are always linearly dependent. A triad of coplanar vectors are always linearly dependent. A pair of non-collinear vectors are always linearly independent. And a triad of non-coplanar vectors are always linearly independent. Okay. And remember, more than three vectors will always become linearly dependent. Right? 4, 5, 6 vectors, they will always become linearly dependent. Okay. Okay, no problem, Aniruddha. Fine. So where are we going to use this linear independent, linearly dependent? So far we have been talking about these concepts without any application to it. So now time to see where do we apply it. So we'll be directly applying it to these theorems, and via these theorems we'll be studying the concept of collinearity of two vectors. Okay. By the way, this concept should not be new to you, because when I was talking about scalar multiplication, you already learned how to make a vector collinear to other. Okay. So here the concept is, if your vector A and B are collinear. Collinear means what? I mean, in your mind, this image should come in your mind. A is like this, B is like this. Okay. That means they are parallel to each other. By the way, direction can be ulta also, no problem. Okay. So if vector A and B are collinear, then A and B become linearly dependent, are linearly dependent, right? That means if you express XA plus, or let's say M1A, since I've been using M1, M2, so let me continue with that trend. So if you express M1, M2 like this, why am I writing A2 and A1? B and A I was talking about, right? So let me use that. If this is a null vector, then M1, M2, both are not, both should be, at least both should not be zero. Okay. In other words, you could express A as minus M2 B by M1, which means you can express A as some lambda times B. This is the simple and straightforward meaning that vector A and B are collinear. That means one could be expressed as some lambda times B. Are you getting my point? Which means that if A and B are not collinear, what will happen? So if A and B are not collinear, let's look at the other face of this concept. If A and B are non-collinear, then A and B are linearly independent. That means if you try to express, M1A plus M2B as a null vector, then the only conclusion is both A1, M1 and M2 are zero. Getting my point? Okay. So this was the concept of collinearity of two vectors. I'll give you a simple question, just a very, very basic question to make you this, to make this concept clear in your mind. Are these two vectors, let's say minus I plus 2j plus k and 2i minus 4j minus 2k, are these two vectors collinear? I think most of you can answer it within 1 second also. See, I already started getting the answer. Yes, they are collinear. Why? If you use this logic, things will be quite fast. Okay, so use this. I recommend this to you always. So if you want to ensure whether two vectors are collinear, you should be able to figure out whether one could be expressed as a linear or a, sorry, one could be expressed as a scalar times the other. Okay. So here you can say minus half times 2i minus 4j minus 2a. So there exists a lambda, right? There exists a lambda belonging to real number for which this is possible, right? If A and B were non-collinear, you will never be able to find a lambda like this, right? Lambda will never exist such that you could express A as lambda B or B as lambda A. Are you getting my point? Okay. If you want to use the other mechanism, that means if you want to use this part, that means M1, M2 both not zero, then you have to use the fact like M1, let M1 minus I plus 2j plus k plus M2 2i minus 4j minus 2k, let it be a zero vector. Okay. If it is a zero vector, you will get minus M1 plus 2m2 equal to zero. I'm comparing the I coefficient. This is your j coefficient and this is your k coefficient, which will all mean the same thing to you actually. Okay. They all mean the same thing. They all mean the same. They're all same. Okay. So if you solve any one of them, there can be definitely non-zero values of M1, M2 existing. Okay. For example, M1 can be 1, M2 could be half, like that. Getting my point? Anything that you would like to know more about this? In fact, we'll be doing problems later on. But concept-wise, any clarification that you need, please type CLR if things are clear. Okay. I'm going to extend this concept of collinearity of two vectors to collinearity of three position vectors. So I'm going to extend this to concept of collinearity of three position vectors. three position vectors. Also, you can say 3 points. Okay. So let's say we have points A, B, and C. Points A, B, and C. Whose position vector is vector A, vector B, vector C. Okay. Now, if these three vectors are collinear, if these three vectors are collinear, then any one of these situations is going to be true. That is, either your AB vector would be some lambda times AC, or your AC vector would be some lambda times BC, or something like, let's say, AB vector, AC vector is lambda times, or you can say okay. So any of these three conditions would hold true. That means if you make any two vectors by using these 3 points, they themselves would be collinear. Isn't this very obvious? Because if they all lie in a straight line, if you can draw a straight line through them. So let's say if I choose AB vector like this, and if I choose BC vector like this, let me choose a different color. Aren't AB and BC themselves collinear? Correct? That means I'm using this concept. Or aren't AB and AC vector themselves collinear? That means I'm using this concept. Or aren't AC and BC vector themselves collinear? That means I'm using this concept. So if any one of these conditions, please note any one, you don't have to show all the three, okay? Any one is fine. So if any one of these conditions hold good, then you can safely conclude that your points A, B, C are in a single line. That means they are collinear, right? This is the easier part of the concept. Achha, by the way, what if they are non-collinear, right? What will happen if A, B, C are not collinear? Are not collinear, then what will happen? You will never be able to find a lambda such that you could do this, or you could do this, or you could do this. Okay, so no such lambda would exist. No such lambda would exist such that one could be expressed as a scalar times the other. Getting my point? Now, this is one way of looking at it. Second way of looking at it is, that is a slightly more challenging way. This is the easier way. So normally I call it as the easy way, easier method. Okay. This is a slightly challenging method. That is the second method. If your vectors A, B, C are collinear, if these three vectors are collinear, then if you express these vectors linear combination as a null vector, okay, then it implies m1 plus m2 plus m3 should be zero, but m1, m2, m3 are not all zero. Very important. Please note this down. This is a concept which confuses a lot of people. Many people don't remember this also. Many people just take the first method because this is an easy method. This method is slightly challenging, but nevertheless, we should know it actually. Okay. The concept is, again, I'm repeating, if your vectors A, B, C are collinear, if your vectors A, B, C are collinear, and you express a linear combination of these vectors as a null vector, then m1 plus m2 plus m3 should be zero, But M1, M2, M3 are not all zero. Right? One way M1, M2 plus M3 could be zero is when all of them are zero, right? Zero, zero, zero. But here, they should not be all zero. That is the idea here. Getting my point? Okay. How is this property actually coming into picture? Let's try to understand this. This property comes from the fact of section formula. Let's say A, B, and C are collinear. Correct. That means B should divide the join of A and C in some ratio. So let's say X and Y, there are some value. Remember, X and Y cannot be both zero. Okay. So I can express B as XC plus YA by X plus Y. Correct? If you cross multiply, it will be X plus YB is equal to XC plus YA. Correct? In other words, if you group your ABC at one place, you will get YA minus X plus YB plus XC is equal to null vector. Right? Now this is playing the role of M1. This is playing the role of M2. This is playing the role of M3. Right? In other words, you are basically trying to do M1A, M2B, M3C is equal to null vector. Correct? So here you can see M1, M2 plus M3 will actually become a zero value because it is actually this term. That is what I said over here. But X, Y, etc., they are not zero. X is not zero, Y is not zero. Okay. That is the meaning of this term. M1, M2, M3 are not all zeros. Does it make sense? Everyone. Okay. If this makes sense to you, I have a question for all of us. Clear? Let's have a question. Very simple one to begin with. So the question is quite clear. The vectors this, this, and this have their initial point at 1, 1. Find the value of lambda so that these vectors terminate on one straight line. Okay. One thing, let's have it as a norm. Whenever you are saying some answer, please message me privately. Okay. So that others are not influenced by that answer. Okay, fine. So anybody who's answering me, please message it privately to me. Okay, it's fine as for now. So those who did not understand the question, it's basically like this. There are three vectors, all of them originate from 1, 1. Okay, so there's a vector like this. Okay, there's a vector like this. There's a vector like this. Okay. So let's say this vector is 2i plus 3j. This vector is 5i plus 6j. And this vector is 8i plus lambda j. And all these vectors terminate on a line. You have to find the value of lambda. Okay. Now, plain and simple, if all these vectors eliminate on a line, that means these vectors A, B, C, position vectors, okay, they must be collinear. Correct. How do I find the position vector of A? Yeah. All of you are correct. Those who have answered, you are all correct. Okay. So how do I find the position vector of A? Remember, 1, 1 is as good as saying I plus J. Okay. So this vector is 2I plus 3J. Let me call this as point P. Okay. So PA vector is 2I plus 3J. So what is your point A then? It's very obvious that PA means position vector of A minus position vector of P. This is 2I plus 3J. So OA will be nothing but OP plus 2I plus 3J. That is nothing but I plus J plus 2I plus 3J. That's 3I plus 4J. So this point is 3i plus 4j. Similarly, this point will be 6i plus 7j. And this vector will be 9i plus lambda plus 1j. Now these three vectors are on the same line. Right? So can I use the fact that AB is some scalar times So AB vector could be expressed as some scalar times. You can call it as, let's say, beta. Beta times any other vector. You can say AC or BC, whatever you want. Okay, so beta times, let's say, AC. Okay, where beta is some scalar quantity. Okay, so what is AB vector? AB vector is B minus A, which is actually 3i plus 3j. Is equal to beta times AC vector is what? 6i plus lambda minus 3j. Hope you know how to find vectors when their endpoints are given. Okay. Just compare the coefficients. 3 is equal to 6 beta. That means beta is equal to half. And 3 is equal to beta, which is half times lambda minus 3. So lambda minus 3 is 6. So lambda is equal to 9. Plain and simple. Please type clear if this is clear to you. All right, let's move on to the next question. If A and B are two non-collinear vectors, show that the points given by L1A plus M1B, L2A plus M2B, and L3A plus M3B are collinear if this determinant is zero. Just type done if you're done with it. Okay, Chirag. Yeah, that's another way to do it, Aniruddha. Exactly. Actually, I was going to do it that way also, but first try to deal things in vectors. Later on, you would have a tendency to convert things into Cartesian. But actually, if you do that, it sends a very wrong signal to the examiner that you are not good in vectors. That's why you are relying too much upon Cartesian. As I already told you, vectors and coordinate geometry are very closely linked to each other. But once the question is given in vector, try to work it out in terms of vector only. Of course, you can make use of other concepts like determinant and all may be used. Done, anyone? Okay, let me take this concept up. Oh, Gaurav is done. Great. So let me take this concept up. I'll solve this in two ways. Okay. If you're saying the vector A, B are non-collinear, okay, just like your I and J vector, that means they are linearly, A and B are linearly independent, right? Correct, okay. Now, if you're saying these three points are collinear, that means, let me call this point as point A, B, and C. Okay. So AB could be expressed as some lambda times any two vector you can take. Let me take it as AC vector. Okay. So AB vector is nothing but vector B minus vector A. Correct? So if you do that, you get B minus A. So L1 minus L2. Should be some lambda times AC vector. That is C minus A. That is L3 minus L1A. Correct. What does it imply? It implies L2 minus L1 is lambda times L3 minus L1. Right? Why? Because A and B are linearly independent. So whatever are the coefficients of A on the left hand side of the equation, the same must be the coefficient of A on the right hand side. So I'm just comparing the coefficients. So I'm comparing this with lambda into this term. Similarly, M2 minus M1 is some lambda times M3 minus M1. Okay. Now, let us look at this determinant given to you in the question. Okay. Let us subtract row number or column number 1 from the other two columns. So, L1, M1, 1. L2 minus L1, M2 minus M1, 0. L3 minus L1, M3 minus M1, 0. Okay, what actually have I done? I've taken the determinant and I've done this operation. C2 is C2 minus C1. C3 is C3 minus C1. Okay, we'll do that method also, Varav, don't worry. Right, now you can see that L2 minus L1 is lambda times L3 minus L1. So you can basically write L1 M1 1. This you can write it as lambda L3 minus L1, lambda M3 minus M1, 0. L3 minus L1, M3 minus M1, 0. Correct? Now take lambda common from C2. Take lambda common from C2. If you do that, your determinant becomes L1, M1, 1, L3 minus L1, M3 minus M1, 0, L3 minus L1, M3 minus M1, 0. That means these two columns have become identical. They have become identical. That means this particular determinant collapses and becomes a 0. That's what we wanted to show. This is one way. Okay, and I've taken the easier method to do it. Let us try to do the same by using the other method also, which I said is slightly more challenging and normally people don't like using that method. So we'll use that method also to prove that this determinant would be zero. By the way, any doubt regarding this method? This is clear? Okay. So I will use the other method as well to prove it. So if you're saying that these three points are collinear, if these three points are collinear, can I say that second method? Can I say that M1, L1A, M1B plus M2, L2A, M2B, plus M3, L3A, M3B, if expressed as null, would result into M1 plus M2 plus, oh, I've already used M1, M2, M3. Oh, so sorry. Let me use XYZ to be more. Okay. I've already made use of M1, M2, M3 here, right? So we can't use it again. So let me use XYZ. So this should imply X plus Y plus Z should be zero, but not all XYZ must be zero. Correct? Yes or no? This is the meaning of saying the three points, this, this, and this are collinear, right? This is what we had discussed. Okay. Now, if you look at this equation and you try to find out the coefficient of A, it is XL1, YL2, ZL3. Coefficient of B would be XM1, YM2, ZM3, right? Equal to null vector. Now, since A and B, as A and B are non-collinear, implies A and B are linearly independent. If they're linearly independent, remember, these scalar quantities must individually be zero. Correct. So this implies XL1, YL2, ZL3 must be zero, and XM1, YM2, ZM3 must be zero, right? So indirectly speaking, you got three equations now. One is this equation, other is this equation, and other is this equation. Basically, you got a system of homogeneous linear equations, correct? And this system of homogeneous linear equations must have a non-trivial solution. This must have a non-trivial solution. Why a non-trivial solution all of a sudden? Because remember, not all XYZ must be zero. Okay. Now go back to your determinant chapter and try to recall the condition when a system of homogeneous equation has a non-trivial solution. Non-trivial solution means non-zero values of XYZ should exist. Okay. When can that happen? That can only happen when the determinant made by the coefficients of these equations, right? So right now, what are the equations that we have? One, this is the coefficient 1, 1, 1. Here I have L1, L2, L3. Here I have M2, M1, M2, M3. So the determinant made by the coefficient of these equations, L1, L2, L3, M1, M2, M3, 1, 1, 1 must be equal to 0. And this is exactly what I required to prove. This is exactly what I required to prove. This is what I wanted to prove. Done. Are you getting this point? See, both the methods, I use both the methods to prove it. The thing is, the process must be clear in your mind. Is it clear? Anything that you would like to ask me from this, especially the second method? I'm sure first method is quite clear to everyone. Anything that you would like to ask, you can unmute yourself and ask me. Clear? Okay. If this is clear, we'll not talk about coplanarity of three vectors. Okay. By the way, some people ask me, sir, you talked about collinearity of three points. Why didn't you talk about collinearity of two points? Right? Let me tell you, two points are always collinear. Okay. In a similar way, many people ask me, why don't you talk about coplanarity of two vectors? Let me tell you, two vectors are always coplanar. Are you getting my point? two vectors are always coplanar. Many of us would think like, okay, let's say a vector is like this and other is like this. Let's say there's Q. Then you cannot form a plane, right? Something like, a road is going like this and a flyover is being constructed over it like this. Of course, it is not coplanar because there's Q. But remember, we are dealing with free vectors. When you're dealing with free vectors, you can bring one vector in plane of the other always by moving it parallel to itself. Okay. So three vectors, we always talk about coplanarity of three or more vectors because two vectors are always coplanar. Getting my point? Fine. So please try to recall the concept. Try to recall the theorem that if three vectors are coplanar, they are linearly dependent. If three vectors are coplanar, they are linearly dependent. So if vector A, B, and C are coplanars, no problem, Ahriman, are coplanar, then A, B, C are linearly dependent. Okay. In other words, one vector could be expressed as some scalar times the other two vector. Getting a point? Here, X and Y pair is a unique pair. Why I'm saying unique? Because there's only one way you can express C as XA plus YB. That means X and Y, only one such pair will exist. They cannot be multiple such pairs. Okay. I'm assuming here that A, B, C are pairwise collinear, are pairwise non-collinear. Okay. That means A is non-collinear to B, B is non-collinear to C, and C is non-collinear to A. Okay. So please make a note of this, right? Now people ask me, what if they're non-coplanar, what will happen? Okay, so let me write that condition also. If A, B, C are non-coplanar, okay, then expressing this would lead to inconsistent values of X and Y. Would lead to inconsistent values of X and Y. Let me try to explain this through a simple example. Okay, let me try to explain this through a simple example. Let's say we have by the way, if you want to copy this down, you can copy it quickly. Okay. Before I give you a problem, let me show you that X and Y pair is unique. You cannot have more than one XY pair for expressing C in terms of A and B. Okay. So let me explain first. Proof for uniqueness of X and Y. Let's say C could be expressed not only in terms of A and B like this, but also C can also be expressed as PA plus QB. Correct? Now, ultimately, both of them represent the same vector. That means XA plus YB should be equal to PA plus QB. Correct? In other words, X minus PA, Y minus QB must be equal to a null vector. Now, since A and B are non-collinear, it implies A and B are linearly independent. And if they're linearly independent, what have I told you? That individually both these terms must be 0, 0, just like I and J. Okay, remember, take the example of I and J in your mind whenever you are confused with this. So this two expression must be individually be zero. That means your P becomes X and Q becomes Y. That means this pair X comma Y is unique. It implies X comma Y pair is unique. Okay. Now let me cite an example. What do I mean when I say when the vectors are non-coplanar, there would be inconsistent values of X and Y will come up if you try to do this C as a linear combination of A and B. Okay, let me give you a question. Are these vectors coplanar? Coplanar means do they lie on the same plane? Or you can, can you pass a plane through these three vectors? Okay. Now, let us try to apply. Let me go back to the previous page. Let us try to apply this concept. Let us try to express a vector, one of the vectors, as a linear combination of the other two, and try to see whether do I get a unique value of X and Y, or do I get an inconsistent value of X and Y? Okay, let's try that out. So let me express any one of them. It's not like, you know, you have to express the first one in terms of the other two. Nothing like that. Any one you pick up. Let's say I pick up the last one. 4i minus 2j minus 3k. And I try to express it as X times, let's say, the first vector. Okay, plus Y times the second vector. Okay, let me try to compare the I, J and K coefficients. So 4 is equal to minus 2X minus 2Y. That means X plus Y is minus 2. Number one equation. Second equation is minus 2 is minus 2X plus 4Y. That means X minus 2Y is 1. Okay, that's the second equation. Okay, third equation is going to be minus 3 is equal to 4x minus 2y. Okay, first let me try to solve 1 and 2 and try to see whether the third one is also satisfied by the same result. Correct? So if I solve this, let me subtract it. So 3y is equal to minus 3, so y is equal to minus 1. So X plus 2 is equal to 1. So X is also equal to minus 1. Okay. Let me check whether this satisfies it. Minus 3 is equal to minus 4. And this is going to be plus 2. No, this is not correct. That means here XY value is inconsistent. XY value is inconsistent. It doesn't satisfy my third equation. If it doesn't satisfy my third equation, what conclusion do I draw? Conclusion should I draw? No, they are non-coplanar. Is that clear, everyone? Please type clear if it is clear. Okay. Now, there's a simpler way to look at it. Right now, focus on these three equations. All of you, please focus on these three equations. Okay. If you look at these three equations, basically, these equations are these three equations. correct? Now these are basically three lines, okay? So when I say if they're coplanar, they should have a common solution. That is what I mean to say, consistent unique pair of x and y. That means these three lines must have a common solution. In other words, they must be concurrent. Okay, if they're concurrent, please try to recall your straight lines chapter in your class 11. You have learned that if a1x plus b1y plus c1 equal to 0, a2x plus b2y plus c2 equal to 0, and a3x plus b3y plus c3 equal to 0, if these three lines are concurrent, everybody knows the meaning of concurrent. Concurrent means all of them will pass through a common point. This is the meaning of concurrency. Then remember, we had learned this, that this determinant must be zero. That is the determinant formed by the coefficients of x and y, and the constant term must be zero. Correct? You can actually use the same thing and make your life easy. Okay, so let's check whether the determinant formed by these coefficients. So what are these coefficients? 2, 2, 4, 2, minus 4, minus 2, 4, minus 2, 3. Is it 0? Let's check. So let me expand it. So 2 times minus 12, minus 4, minus 2 times 6 plus 8, and 4 times minus 4 plus 16. This is going to be minus 32. This is going to be minus 28. And this is going to be 48. I'm sure this is not zero. Okay. If they're not zero, means they are not concurrent. If they're not concurrent, means they will not have a common value of x and y satisfying it. And if they don't have a common value of x and y satisfying it, that means there's an inconsistency in the value of x and y. And hence these three vectors are non-coplanar. Okay. By the way, one more important finding over here. The finding is, if you see these numbers here, 2, 2, 4, 2 minus 4 minus 2, 4 minus 2 and 3, you would realize that you could actually also write it as, let me write it here. You could also write it as 2, 2, 4. 2 minus 4 minus 2 and 4 minus 2, 3. Correct? Basically, I have tried to transpose it, but they are actually a symmetric matrix, so nothing happened. So if this is 0, let's say if this is 0, you could actually make these numbers as the, let's say I put a minus 2, minus 2. And this I put as minus 2 plus 4 minus 2, 4 minus 2, 4 minus 2, minus 3. This will actually form the coefficients of these three vectors which were provided to us. Correct? So this brings me to one more important theory that you will anyways learn later on. That's an easy method to find the coplanarity of three vectors. Easy method to check the... Everybody, please make a note of this. Easy method to check the coplanarity of three vectors. Let's say the vectors are a1, I, a2, j, a3, k, b1, I, b2, j, b3, k, and C1i, C2j, C3k. If you want to check whether these three vectors are coplanar or not, then you just put these coefficients of ijk in form of a determinant like this. And if this determinant happens to be zero, then yes, they are coplanar. Okay. And if this determinant is not equal to zero, that means this is not equal to zero, That means it implies they are non-coplanar. Okay. This is a much easier and effective way to solve or prove the coplanarity of vectors. Is that fine? Clear, everyone? Can we take a problem on this? Let's take a question on this. Oh, sorry. This is a question on collinearity. Let me check. Yeah, the question is in front of you. If A, B, C are non-coplanar vectors, prove that these three vectors are also non-coplanar. That's the first part of the question. Second part of the question is, if these vectors are non-coplanar, prove that A is 4. Yes, there's a slight mistake in this question. I wanted to check whether you're getting it right. It's actually A equal to minus 4. You're correct, Aniruddha. Okay, most of you are done. Good. So first part, if A, B, C are coplanar, prove that these vectors are also coplanar. Okay. So if you want to prove that these vectors are coplanar. Now remember, this is very similar to saying that your A is like your I cap, B is your like J cap, and C is your like K cap, which themselves are non-coplanar, correct? So prove that 3i minus 7j minus 4k, 3i minus 2j plus k, and I plus j plus 2k are coplanar. Okay, indirectly you are trying to prove that. Okay, I'm sure many of you would have directly made that determinant, correct? But let me tell you, you should also mention the fact that one could be expressed as, okay, linear combination of the other two. Okay, which ends up giving you 3x plus y is equal to 3. Okay, minus 2x plus y is equal to minus 7. And x plus 2y is equal to minus 4. Okay, that means 3x plus y minus 3 equal to 0, minus 2x plus y plus 7 equal to 0, and x plus 2y plus 4 equal to 0. So if this should have consistent solution, that means they must be concurrent. So let us check the determinant formed by the coefficients over here. So 3, 1, minus 3, minus 2, 1, 7. Okay, let's find this value. So 3, 4 minus 14 is minus 10, minus 1, minus 8, minus 7, and minus 3, minus 4, minus 1. That will give you minus 30 plus 15 plus 15. And yes, it is coming out to be 0. That means these three vectors are coplanar. Okay, that's the first part of the question. Second part of the question, if these three vectors are coplanar, prove that A is minus 4. So here you can directly use your determinant. 2 minus 1, 1. 1, 2 minus 3. 3A, 5. This must be equal to 0. Let us expand this. So you'll get 2 times 10 plus 3a plus 1. You'll get 5 plus 9, which is 14. And plus 1a minus 6, which is, should be equal to 0, which is nothing but 20 plus 14 minus 6. And this is going to be 4a. Okay. I think it gives you... Why did I write a 4a over here? That's 7a, right? Sorry. Let me just correct this. 7a. Okay. So this gives you 7a is equal to minus 28. So a is equal to minus 4. Clear, everyone? How does it work? Any doubt regarding solution of this question? Please punch clear if things are clear. Great. Next concept that we are going to talk about is the concept of coplanarity of 4 points or 4 position vectors. Coplanarity of 4 points or 4 position vectors. Now, again, remember, I'm not going to talk about coplanarity of 3 points because 3 points will always be coplanar. Getting my point? You can always pass a plane through any 3 points. Fine. So let's say A, B, C are 4 points A, B, C, and D are 4 points with the following position vectors. Okay. If they are coplanar, please note the vectors formed by choosing any two of these points. So let's say I make three vectors, AB, AC, and AD. Then these three vectors are also coplanar. Plain and simple. So what are you doing? You're just using your previous concept to handle this. So if you know how to prove the coplanarity of three vectors, you can actually also prove the coplanarity of 4 points. Simple, you just have to make three vectors out of those 4 points. And any three vector you can make, not necessarily A, B, A, C, A, D. You can make A, B, B, C, B, D, okay? Any, let me write it as any three vectors formed from these 4 points will be coplanar. Are you getting this point? Now, I'm not going to talk about it because you already know this condition. This is already known to you. So you can manage it through the use of the test of coplanarity of three vectors. Correct? There's an alternate method also. If these four points are coplanar, that means there's one more way to actually prove their coplanarity. That means if you choose, let's say, x, y, z, w scalar quantities such that this is equal to null vector, then this implies x plus y plus z plus w should be zero, but all not zero. This is another way to prove it. Okay, but this is less used, this is more widely used. Okay, so this is slightly complicated. The second method is slightly complicated. First method is more widely used. Is that fine? Let's take a question on this. So please read this question. Question says, the position vectors of the point A, B, C, D are given to you like this. This is your A. This is your B. This is your C and this is your D. By the way, this is 4 plus 4i. 4i plus 5j plus lambda. Okay. So if these 4 points A, B, C, D lie on a plane, they lie on a plane, find the value of lambda. Please type in your response once you're done. Okay, what is that method, Anirudh? I've already discussed two methods. Can you just do it and send me a pic on my WhatsApp? See, one method implies the other. It's not like they are exclusive of each other. There has to be a connect between both the methods. So when I say method one, method two, it's not like both are mutually exclusive of each other. One is basically expressing the same thing in its own way. Oh, okay. Never mind. After the class, you can share the method with me. I'll be interested in seeing what you have done. Oh my God, that's a horrible answer. So, okay. Right now, I don't know the answer, but let's solve it. Let's see the response from other people. So Akarsh has already told me some answer. I don't know whether it's right or wrong right now, Akarsh. Let's wait for a few more people to answer in. Okay, Ariman has a different answer altogether. Fine. Anybody else? Now I realize that figures are quite ugly for you all. Yeah. Vidushi has some different answer. Shaunak is asking for a minute. Okay. Not getting confused. Mm-hmm. No worries, Chirag. We'll deal with it. Just let's give others 1 minute. Okay. Shaunak is getting a different answer. Fine. So let us make quickly three vectors out of it. AB, AC, and AD probably. Okay. So AB will be what? AB will be B minus A vector. So B minus A vector will be minus I plus 5j minus 3k. Okay, remember for AB vector, you just have to do OB minus OA. That is position vector of B minus position vector of A. So I subtracted 2i minus 3i, which is minus I. 3j plus 2j, which is 5j. And minus 4k plus k, which is minus 3k. Okay. AC vector will be C minus A vector. So C minus A will be minus 4i plus 3j plus 3k. Okay. Minus 3i plus 3j and plus 3k. AC vector would be AD vector will be I plus 7j. And you'll have lambda plus 1k. Okay. Now these three vectors must be coplanar for these three points to be coplanar. That means the determinant formed by minus 1, 5, minus 3, minus 4, 3, 3, 1, 7, lambda plus 1 should be 0. Let us expand with respect to the third row. So 1 into, hide this, 15 plus 9, which is going to be 15 plus 9 is 24. Minus 7, hide this. Minus 3 minus 12 is minus 15. And finally, lambda plus 1 times minus 3 plus 20, which is 17. Okay. So let us simplify this. 24, and this is going to be 105 plus 17 plus 17 lambda equal to 0. So this gives you the answer lambda as minus 146 by 17. Okay, all of you started realizing where you went wrong. Clear? Okay. Now, how would I solve this problem if I had to use the previous method? If you have to use the second method. Okay. In second method, if you want these three vectors to be coplanar, remember we had to express this as a null vector. And this should imply x plus y plus z plus w should be 0, right? Let us do that as well. So let's write a vector here. A is our 3i minus 2j minus k. Y, b will be 2i plus 3j minus 4k. Plus z minus I plus j plus 2k plus w. Let me check the other vector. It is 4, 5 lambda. 4, 5 lambda. 4, 5 lambda. This must be equal to null. Correct? So if you compare the coefficients of x, it will be, if you compare the coefficients of I, it will be 3x plus 2y minus z plus 4w equal to 0. That's one equation. Compare the coefficients of j, minus 2x plus 3y plus z plus 5w must be 0. Compare the coefficients of k, which is minus x minus 4y plus 2z plus lambda w equal to 0. And the fourth equation is x plus y plus z plus w equal to 0. Remember, here x, y, z, w, not all zero. They are not all zero. That means this homogeneous equation must have a non-trivial solution. That's the meaning of not all zero, right? 0, 0, 0 is of course a solution, but we don't want that to happen. It must have a non-trivial solution. That means what is happening, my good friends over here? The 4 by 4 determinant over here must be equal to 0. Getting my point? I think for the first time you're dealing with a 4 by 4, right? Never mind. So here also all the properties are valid, 4 by 4 determinant. You can do one thing. You can take your column number 1 and subtract it from other columns. So I can do. Okay. Take your first column, subtract it from the other columns. So what will happen? This will remain same, 3 minus 2 minus 1, 1. This will become a minus 1, 5 minus 3, 0, minus 4, 3, 3, 0. This will become a 1, 7, lambda plus 1, 0. Okay. Now let us expand with respect to the first, respect to the last row. Expand with respect to R4. Okay. So it will become 1. Only this part will be seen, which is actually the determinant formed by minus 1, minus 4, 1, 5, 3, 7, minus 3, 3, lambda plus 1. This should be equal to 0. Okay. Let us expand this. Let me expand with respect to the third row over here. So minus 3. This will become minus 28 minus 3, which is minus 31. Again, a minus 3. Minus 7 minus 5, which is minus 12. And lambda plus 1 times minus 3 plus 20, which is 17. Okay. So this will give you 93 plus 36 plus 17 plus 17 lambda equal to 0. Right, which gives you 17 lambda is minus 146. So lambda is minus 146 by 17. Yet again, okay. Actually, I'm happy to see this. That's why I put this smiley. So that's how you get the solution in an alternate way, but by using a 4 by 4. Now, do you realize why people hate the other method? Why people don't write this? Because it leads to a 4 by 4 determinants to solve. But nevertheless, this determinant is also easy to solve because thankfully we get all 1, 1, 1s in one of the rows. Okay. Because this will always be there as a equation for you. Is it clear or not? Please punch clear if it is clear to you. Great. Questions. Let's take questions. Okay. Let's take a slightly different question altogether. Points A, B, C, D are related as this and this, where x, y, z, w are scalars. Sum of any two x, y, z, w is not zero. Prove that if a, b, c, d are concyclic, then this equation must be true. Anybody who is done can send their working to me personally on WhatsApp. Coincyclic means all these 4 points lie on a circle. So if 4 points are coincyclic, they will lie on a circle. So let's say these are your 4 points. A, B, C, D. So these are your position vectors. A, that means you can always make a quadrilateral with them, but anyways, you don't need that. They're just coincyclic. Let's say this is point P. Anyone? Anyone is trying at least? If not, I can start solving. Okay. Yes, anyone? Any idea? Okay, let's talk about it. The first thing that you would all know that in if there are two chords which are intersecting at a single point, okay, then PA into PB is equal to PC into PD. Okay, PA into PB is equal to PC into PD. How many of you are not aware of this? Or how many of you want me to prove this first? Just let me know if you are not aware of this. Just write not aware. Okay, that means I have not got any response, means everybody is aware. Okay. By the way, the proof of it is very simple. If you connect a triangle like this, you know that this angle is this angle, right? Let me call this as angle X, angle X. This angle is angle Y, this angle is angle Y. And of course, these two are ZZ each, okay? That means triangle PAD is similar to triangle. Oh, well done, Vidushi. Can you send me the solution? Triangle PAD is similar to triangle PCB. Okay. So I can say PA by PD is PC by PB. So PA by PD is equal to PC by PB. Okay. Cross multiply. So this implies PA into PB is equal to PD into PC. Correct? Now, let's go back to the same question once again. Now, it has been given that xc plus yb plus zc plus wd. By the way, let me remove these xy because they've already been used up in the question so that you're not confused with this x and y on the and the x and y given in the question. So let me just erase this. Is that fine? So what is given to us is that xa plus yb plus zc plus wd equal to a null vector implies xy x plus y plus z plus w is equal to zero. Okay. So now if you look at this term carefully, what does this imply? This implies that A, B, C, D are coplanar. Correct? A, B, C, D are coplanar. What else does it imply? What else does it imply? What are these X, Y, Z, and W? Does anybody have any idea what does this X, Y, Z, and W actually represent? Vidushi, what does X, Y, Z, and W actually represent? Exactly. They actually represent this ratio. This is your x, y, z, and w terms. Okay. How do you know that? That's also very simple. If you see this point P is nothing but XA plus YB by X plus Y. Okay. The same point P is also ZC plus WD by Z plus W. Getting my point? Correct? Now, from here, how do I conclude that XA plus YB plus WD is equal to a null vector and XYZW is equal to zero? How do I conclude that? Vidushi?
So could you repeat 1 second?
My question is, from here, from these two expressions, how do you conclude that this is zero and this is equal to a null vector? From here, from these two conditions, how is it evident that these two conditions that is mentioned in the question are satisfied? That is, this and this are satisfied. Anyone? I mean, this is an open question to all of you. Tridib, Aryaman. All I can conclude from here is this, right? XA plus YB by X plus Y is equal to ZC plus WD by Z plus W. Yes or no? So from here, how do I conclude? From here, how do I conclude that XA plus YB plus ZC plus WD is going to be a null vector and X plus Y plus Z plus W is equal to zero? That is my question. How do I get to these two conditions? If these two conditions are proved, that means the reverse is also true. That means this ratio is justified, correct? So once we have justified this, we have to come back to this conclusion also, because both imply each other. Right? Okay. Anyway, I'll give you some time to prove this. Okay. Think about it. Now, meanwhile, let us say we take this ratio to be correct. Then what do we conclude? How do we use this? We can use this equation now. PA into PB is equal to PC into PD. Okay. So PA, what is PA length? Can I say PA length would be, I'll refer to this figure only here. Can I say PA length will be Y by X plus Y times, okay? This length itself is mod of A minus B. Okay, now you can see how these terms are making their appearance. Okay. Similarly, PB would be what? By the way, let me take a mod over here in case your X and Y is negative. Okay. PB would be what? PB would be similarly X by X plus Y times mod A minus B. Okay. What about PC? PC length would be W by W plus Z times C minus D. W by W plus Z mod times C minus D. And PD length will be Z by W plus Z times C minus D. Okay, if I use this formula now, PA into PB is equal to PC into PD, you will see that I end up getting mod XY by mod X plus Y square A minus B square. Mod WZ by mod this C minus D square. Correct? Now these two are same. Why? Because X plus Y plus Z plus W is equal to zero. That means X plus Y is equal to Z, negative Z plus W. Correct? So modulus of these two quantities would be the same. So square will also be the same. So you can cancel them off. Okay. I think this is what we wanted to prove in this. Mod XY mod A minus B square is mod Y, WZ mod C minus D square. Are you getting my point? Okay. Now, does this ring a bell in your mind that how this will lead to this? So, if you take your Z plus W, let's say you consider this to be correct, then it will be negative X plus Y, isn't it? So, if you take that, then what will happen? This will become negative XC plus WD by X plus Y. That means it will lead to XA plus YB plus ZC plus WD equal to a null vector. That means if you assume this to be true, you can actually prove this and vice versa. So ultimately, by the use of these two, you can prove this to be true. And from this, you can actually conclude that this is how the ratio is basically divided. So this is a very good problem, which actually tells you that the second method that we were using, what was that X, Y, Z and W in that? Getting my point? Can we take up next question now? Let's take this question. It's a geometry based question, but you have to do it by using vectors. Let P be an interior point of a triangle ABC. and AP, BP, CP meet the sites BC, CA, AB in DEF respectively, show that AP by PD is AF by FB plus AE by EC. Yes, anyone, please type done if you're done. Let me sketch a figure meanwhile. So A, so P is some interior point, such that AP, BP and CP meets the side. Okay, so AP, BP and CP it meets the side BC in D, E, and F. We have to show AP is to PD is AF is to FB. AF is to FB plus AE is to AC. Okay, so here we can say clearly that A, B, C, and P are coplanar. Correct? So I've given a position vector to all these points. So can I say XA plus YB plus ZC plus WP is equal to a null vector? Okay, then X plus Y plus Z plus W should be equal to zero. Yes or no? Is this thing clear, everyone? How do we use this? How do we use this concept? How do we use this concept to solve this given problem? Okay, now let's look at this expression here and these two expressions. Can I write from here that XA plus YB, okay, is equal to negative ZC plus WP? Okay, let me divide both sides with X plus Y. Now we know from this equation that X plus Y is negative of Z plus W. Correct? So if I replace this denominator term by negative Z plus W, negative negative will go off. Correct? Okay, which means XA plus YB by X plus Y is equal to ZC plus WP by Z plus W. Isn't this resembling section formula? Correct? If this is resembling section formula, tell me, can I conclude anything about xa plus yb by x plus y means this ratio, they are taking it as x is to y. Okay. And they're referring to as F point. The same as ZC is to WP. ZC, CNP point, CNP point. Okay, so CNP point they're referring to. So this point and this point they're referring to. So what is this ratio here? F is dividing the join of C and P externally. In what ratio? This is W is to Z. I think Z ulta. This is your Z and this is your W. Okay. But never mind. We don't need that. We just need this fact that AF is to FB, which is required in our problem. As you can see, AF is to FB is required. That is going to be Y is to X. Okay. Now, I can write down the very same expression over here in a slightly different way. I can write it as XA plus YW, sorry, XA plus WP equal to negative YB plus ZC. Okay. Let me divide by X plus W on both the sides. Now we know that X plus W is negative Y plus Z. So if I replace this with Y plus Z negative, this and this will get cancelled off. Okay. Now what does this tell you? What does this tell you? Let's focus on A and P point. A and P point. And this is B and C point. This is B and C point. So this tells you that point D is nothing but Y is to Z. Correct? Point P is Y is to Z. Okay. And what is this ratio? What is AP is to PD here? AP is to PD is such that this relation must be satisfied by D. This is the position vector of D, remember. This is the position vector of D. XA plus WP by X plus W. So what is this ratio AP by PD? Can anybody tell me? AP by PD. See, it's very simple. Let's say this is K is to 1. This is K is to 1. Okay. So this is the case of external division, right? So according to this formula, your position vector of D should have been K into P. Correct. Minus 1 into A by minus 1 plus K. Correct. Compare these two. If you compare these two, you will come to know that W by X is actually minus one. Okay, W by X is actually your minus K. Correct? Yes or no? So K is minus W by X. Correct? And AP is nothing but K minus 1 is to 1. So I can say AP is to PD. AP is to PD or AP by PD is K minus 1 is to 1. That is nothing but minus W by X minus 1. Yes or no? This is also a very important result for us. So one result is here, Y by X. Other result, AP by PD is minus W by X minus 1. Remember, both of these results are required. AP by PD is required here. And AF by FB is required over here. Now I have to find AE is to AC. How will I do AE is to AC? Now all of you please focus here. AE is to AC connects A and C, right? So keep A and C together. So write it like this. XA plus ZC is minus YB plus WP. Divide by X plus Z both the sides. Divide by X plus Z both the sides. Okay. X plus Z is negative W plus Y. So I can replace this with negative Y plus W, negative, negative, gone. So what does this say? This says that point E coordinates, this is nothing but X is to Z. Okay. So I can say AE by EC is X by Z. AE by EC is equal to X by Z. So this is your number three achievement. Okay. AE by EC is, sorry, Z by X, not X by Z, Z by X. Okay. Now let us try to see whether these three bracketed expressions satisfy this condition or not. So AP by PD, let me write AP by PD, which is nothing but minus W by X minus 1. Okay. And let us do AF by FB, which is Y by X, plus AE by EC, which is nothing but Z by X. So it becomes Y plus Z by X. Now they're claiming that these two are equal. Are they? Let us check. So if you say minus W by X minus 1 is equal to Y minus Z by X, basically, you're trying to say minus W minus X by X is equal to Y plus Z by X. XX cancel. That means you're trying to say X plus Y plus Z plus W is equal to 0, which is, yes, it is true. Okay, it is true from this expression. Here itself, it is mentioned that X plus Y plus Z equal to 0. So yes, whatever is asked here in this particular proof, that is correct. Okay. So basically here we are using a very deep understanding of coplanarity. We are treating these X, Y, Z and W as the ratios in which these points are arranged in space or cutting each other in space or cutting each other in the plane. Getting my point? It's a very beautiful problem which opens a lot of concept. Okay. So I'll just take one more problem here.
Sir, can you explain how you got the ratios again?
Yeah, sure. See, first of all, I took these two terms together, this and this, and I sent these two to the other side. So I got this term. Okay. You understand this expression, right? From here.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Now, basically here, they are pointing towards position vector of 2 points. Here they're pointing towards position vector of 2 points. Okay. So there is a point which divides A and B in some ratio and also C and P in sub ratio. That means that point is collinear with A, B as well as C and P. So any point which is collinear with A and B and also with C and P has to be your F point. Correct? So if you just look at the left hand side of the expression, it indicates to the fact that F is dividing A and B in the ratio of Y is to X. Now look at the reverse. Just try to recall your section formula in reverse. If there is a point whose position vector is this, don't you think that point divides A and B in the ratio of Y is to X? That's how we wrote over here, Y is to X. That's how AF is to FB became Y by X. Is it clear? By the way, who asked this question?
Aditya, sir.
Aditya. So Aditya, can you similarly relate it to the other facts? For example, now when I write it as XA plus WP is equal to YB plus ZC by X plus W and Y plus Z respectively, there is a point which divides A and P. That means it is collinear with A and P. So collinear with A and P is D, which is also collinear with C and B. Are you getting it? So from this understanding, I came to know that D is dividing the join of A and P in some ratio. Here this ratio is external ratio. That's why we got our answer of AP by AD as negative W by X minus 1. In similar way, when I wrote XA plus ZC by X plus C is equal to YB plus WP by Y plus W, it means there is a point which is collinear to A and C. There's a point which is collinear to A and C and also to B and P. Also to B and P, which has to be E point. There's no other point. There's no other point which is simultaneously collinear to A and C as well as B and P. And this gives you a very simple understanding that A and C are divided in the ratio of Z is to X by E point. So AE by EC is equal to Z by X ratio. Once I got that, I just tried to fit into this formula and obtain something which is a fact according to the question. So when I obtain these ratios, I just put it in this and try to equate it to see whether it gives you a truth or not. Correct. And it actually gave me a truth condition. That means this is correct. That means this is correct. This is equal to this is correct. And shown.
Okay, sir. Yeah, understood.
Okay.
Thank you.
It's a very good question, actually, if you see this. Yes, Sridhiv rightly said it's an impossible question if you haven't done this type of question before. Okay. Guys, one thing we'll do is we are going to start with scalar product next class. So I'm going to stop it over here because any other concept which I'm going to take up will just take the flow of the class in the next session. Okay. So I'll start afresh with the concept of dot product and vector product or cross product, what we call it. We'll try to wrap this up in the next class. Okay. I'll also try to cover up scalar triple product in this. Okay. And in the next to next class, we are going to talk about vector triple product and some miscellaneous concept. Miscellaneous concept will include vector equation and all. Okay. Vector equation, system of reciprocal vectors, all those stuff. Lagrange's identity, I wanted to have one class with you on differential equation online. Okay. Probably October 5th, 6th or 7th. Okay. Yeah. Because we don't have much time at our hand. So we have to complete 3D also and a differential equation and area under the curves. So 3D I wanted to do with you in a physical class. Differential equation needs a lot of problem solving. So I wanted to have an online session. Okay. So there would be one of these days when we'll conduct, in fact, two of these days when we'll conduct a class. 8th I'm reserving for the Dashera. 8th you can't do much about it.